All right, we're going to proceed with the physical implications and conceptual model associated with the QG chi equation over here, talking about height tendencies, G potential tendency, where we have negative chi, changes in G potential height, being driven by vorticity advection and differential thermal advection. Let's start with the application here to a shortwave trough embedded within westerly flow over here. We know that our vort max here in the base of the trough is going to be located in this general vicinity. And with background flow spreading across that vort max towards relatively lower vorticity values downstream from the shortwave trough, we're going to have cyclonic vorticity advection occurring downstream. We're going to have our forcing from the QG chi equation, which is what we're talking about over here, is going to be positive, and therefore chi, with that negative sign out front, that's coming from the Laplacian operator acting on chi, we get a negative sign, is going to result in chi being less than zero. So we're going to have height falls occur downstream from the shortwave trough. Height falls downstream from the shortwave trough implies that the shortwave trough is going to be advancing eastward. Let's look upstream where we have anticyclonic vorticity advection occurring. Again, we're not looking at differential vorticity advection, we're just looking at anticyclonic vorticity advection from the QG chi equation. We have relatively lower values of vertical vorticity, and that's being spread towards higher values. Forcing is going to be negative, chi is going to be positive, and we'll have height rises occurring upstream from the shortwave trough with ridging occurring upstream. And so this effectively is used to explain the progression of our wave pattern downstream. That's what the quasi-geostrophic chi equation is saying, that our vorticity advections over here are going to be associated with the downstream progression of our wave. Let's look at the implications from thermal advection, and specifically differential thermal advection. We'll draw our wave pattern over here. Surface low between our shortwave trough and our ridge. We'll have a cold front that trails to the south and southwest of our surface low, and a warm front that it arches to the northeast of our surface low, something like this. Background pattern of warm advection occurring to the north of the warm front. We're going to assume that our thermal advections are maximized in the lower part of the atmosphere, where our thermal gradients arise owing to imbalances in surface heating between the equator and the poles. So our thermal advections are going to be maximized down low in the atmosphere, such that we'll have decreasing magnitude of thermal advection with height above the ground. In this case, the differential thermal advection is going to be negative with decreasing warm advection with height above the ground. And therefore, our forcing is going to be negative. And our G potential heights will be rising as chi is greater than zero. And so in this case, our ridge builds. Alternatively, behind our cold front, where we have cold advection occurring, we'll have negative thermal advection become less negative with height, implying differential thermal advection being positive. So our forcing is going to be positive, and chi will be negative, which results in height falls over here and trough amplification. So the effect of differential thermal advection here using the quasi-geostrophic chi equation will be amplification of our wave pattern. So if we were to extend this a little bit further and consider the case where we have a non-amplifying wave pattern, so our trough is not amplifying, our ridge is not building, so we have a steady state wave pattern, non-amplifying wave pattern, then we can make the assumption that our differential thermal advection term is negligible. If that term were to be negligible over here, then all height changes can be related to vorticity advection. Now, we know through that relationship, that approximation that vorticity advection and differential vorticity advection are related, that in the case of the steady state wave pattern that is not undergoing amplification or deamplification, that all of the height changes can be related to vorticity advection, which can be related to the forcing term in the quasi-geostrophic omega equation to explain vertical motion. So if we were to observe height falls occurring in the mid-levels, for instance, and we're not actually associated with, we're not actually experiencing an amplifying wave pattern, then all of those height falls can be linked to cyclonic vorticity advection that can be linked to differential cyclonic vortices of action that can be linked to upward motion. So the QG chi and QG omega equations can actually be related to one another in the case of the steady state wave pattern that's not undergoing amplification via the relationship between vorticity advection, high tendency vorticity advection, differential vorticity advection, and vertical motion. All right, one other thing I want to mention about the physical implications of the thermal advection pattern over here. Let's consider two pressure surfaces here. We're using pressure as our vertical coordinate. Let's talk about here 700 millibar isobaric surface and 850 millibar isobaric surface. Let's consider the case where we have strong cold advection occurring, cold advection maximum occurring within this layer over here. Cold advection maximum over here. We know that above the level of maximum cold advection, we're going to have a differential thermal advection over here. So we're going to have cold advection maximum over here. So we're going to have less negative thermal advection with height above that particular level. So DT, our differential thermal advection is going to be positive in this case, so we'll have positive forcing, and chi will be negative, which is going to correspond to height falls. So eventually that isobaric surface will be falling below the level of maximum cold advection. We're going to have decreasing thermal advection with height as we approach with height the cold advection maximum. So differential thermal advection will be less than zero. Chi will be greater than zero as we have the negative sign out front on the left-hand side over there. And that particular pressure surface will rise associated with differential thermal advection being negative below the level of maximum cold advection. So effectively, we'll have height rises below the level of maximum cold advection and height falls above the level of maximum cold advection. And our column of air over here will shrink and contract on the level of maximum cold advection. And we can actually see that that is an application not only of the quasi-geostrophic high tendency equation over here, quasi-geostrophic high equation, but also it makes sense that with cooling of the column of air from the hypsometric equation, it will thin. The thickness of this column of air between 850 millibars and 700 millibars will decrease associated with cold advection related to what's going on in between these pressure surfaces. So, you know, it's no memorization needed at all. If we have cold advection occurring over here, yes, indeed, we have height falls occurring above that level of maximum cold advection in order to accomplish the thinning of the column, which occurs in tandem with rising heights down below that level of maximum cold advection associated with that thinning column over here. And at the same time, we have cold advection occurring below that height rises. We also have pressure rises occur as the colder air mass, should say, here is associated with an increase in density and an increase in pressure in the lower part of the atmosphere associated with pressure rises. Alternatively, in the case of warm advection, let's consider our 700 millibar surface over here. An 850 millibar surface over here will have a level of maximum warm advection occurring between those two levels. Let's just look at this now from the hypsometric equation. We know the 700 millibar surface is going to have to, we're going to have expansion of the column of air associated with a rising heights over here associated with the 700 millibar surface. And then for our column to thicken, the 850 millibar surface is going to have to fall over here for our column of air to thicken. Let's test to see if that is actually correct. Above the level of maximum warm advection, we'll have decreasing warm advection with height, so our differential thermal advection is going to be negative over here, and so chi is going to be positive. Yes, that's exactly correct. We have height rises below the level of maximum warm advection. Our differential thermal advection over here is going to be greater than zero as we go up with height. We're going to be experiencing greater amounts of warm advection below the level of maximum warm advection. Differential thermal advection is positive. Chi will be negative, and indeed, consistent with what we saw with the hypsometric equation, our heights will be falling over here as our column of air thickens.